Absolutely, yes. The Morning Drive on News Talk 105.9 WVJ. Hi, Buttercup. My name is Frank Barnes. You're apparently a lovelorn advice columnist here, telling people it's going to be chilly this weekend. So what you got to do is just ramp up and women want to snuggle. It's going to be like 46 degrees on Saturday. 46 degrees Saturday night. You know what that means, Saturday night? That is 14 degrees north of freezing. Yeah. Get a Duraflame log. You'll be absolutely fine. Speaking of being absolutely fine with all the Sturm und Drang und Angst that is fulfilling Congress and everything else, check this out. Congressman Extraordinaire Jack Kingston is in the House, and we'll give him his propers right now. A proper, is it a farewell tour? Let's find out. Good morning, Jack Kingston.
No, it is not a farewell tour. You will not get rid of me that easily. I'll keep coming back, invited or not, official or unofficial.
You'll crash the party. Let's explain what's going on. Redistricting has happened, and you are basically, as it had been before, well, before the redistricting, you're basically from the Atlantic Ocean to the interstate. Is that the best way to phrase it? That was sort of your chunk of real estate there.
That's correct, yes.
And now it's not?
Now I had 25 counties I represent. It's been reduced to about 12 counties. Mm. And so through a last-minute fight, and your delegation was great, I just have to say, I can't say enough things about Amy Carter and Ellis Black and Jason Shaw and Tim Golden for really standing firm, but we were able to get Moody Air Force Base back in the 1st District, so that's why you'll be stuck with me. But as a member of the Defense Committee, it made sense to keep representing the Air Force Base, and I was glad to do it, and I've worked with your leadership on it, and they, in fact, were up in Washington, D.C. last week. So anyway, you are stuck with me. I missed the vote a minute ago, and trust me, I would not have picked up the phone. I just want your audience to know that the QE was made, tailor-made for Frank Barnes to jump. I mean, you just leaped into this thing.
You want me to be shy about this? His Facebook was 45 in each group, pro and con, so we had to settle the score once and for all.
And the winner, Frank Barnes.
There you
ladies
go.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, y'all see me in my Hawaiian shirt. And by the way, as a congressman, do you want to swear under oath that currently I am wearing a Hawaiian shirt?
You are wearing.
And cowboy boots.
You are wearing one of the ugliest. Actually, it's a black and white version of a Hawaiian shirt. Usually you think of red, blues, yellows, but this is black.
This is like a Magnum PI discount yard sale I got going on. But guys, it's the last day of 90 degrees. When do you want me to wear this? Christmas? That would be wrong.
So you are celebrating. And although it sounds like Frank Barnes is the one also swimming in a pot of coffee, I just want you to know I went by Ileana's. Now, as long as I've represented Valdosta, I've always only come after hours, and I've never gotten to go to Ileana's. And finally, Merritt took me there yesterday, went back first thing this morning. It is a great locally owned business. And I'm
You're two for two days to Ileana's.
You know, I'm a big coffee drinker, and this is great coffee. They need to take this thing nationally.
Yeah? You like that?
Absolutely.
Cool. We love it.
I think some of the national brands could use some good competition, and Ileana's could do it.
There you go. See, the thing is, I go for the hot chocolate. I can't drink coffee.
Caffeine.
I do not drink coffee. I've had 2 cups of coffee my entire life, sir. That's no joke.
Those two cups gave you enough adrenaline for 150
wired.
Years.
I'm wired, yes. And I can't sleep now. Here's the thing. Let's talk about the district. So who do we get? We don't get you. We don't get Sanford Bishop. We get this. Who's this other character?
Well, Austin Scott.
We get Austin Scott?
Yes, and I'm...
Is he a cool guy, or do I have to, like, beat him to submission?
I'm afraid to say he's a cool guy. He's a likable guy. Y'all are going to forget me so quickly.
Oh.
It's going to be sad. I'm going to have a little pity party about it. But he's a good guy and a businessman, has an agriculture background, on the Armed Services Committee. We'll work together on Moody Air Force Base. So, and I'm looking forward to getting him down here. I don't know if it will be for a football game or a town meeting or something like that, but I thought it might be good for the two of us to come to town sometime. And keep in mind, these maps have not been pre-cleared by the Justice Department, so things may change. Last time we did reapportionment, it gave birth to 3 other reapportionments. We had 4 reapportionments in a 5-year period of time.
Ooh.
So these things are well known for going to court and getting everybody stirred up. But
so right now the plan is Sanford Bishop is west of the interstate. You are basically Moody Air Force Base over to the ocean, and Austin Scott gets Valdosta, and he goes up north. north towards Tifton in that area.
Yes, and so I still had the honor of representing the current lines until January 2013, and that's when officially, okay, you know, whoever is elected takes over. And but in the meantime, you know, anybody who needs me, we're trying our best.
You're still on the case.
And so the local Democrat Party, much to their great disappointment, still stuck with Jack
Kingston. You're still around.
But I will continue to work with them or anybody else. And, you know, right now, Frank, it is a time for our country to come together. We're very divided. I was looking at some polling information the other day. Republicans believe we're on the wrong track and Barack Obama needs to get out. Democrats believe we're on the right track and Barack Obama needs to stay in. And independents are split 43% to 43%.
You got to be kidding me.
And so, you know, we are a very divided country right now as to what needs to be done. But I think a couple of things that are relevant. Our founding fathers have set up the system to make it very hard to accomplish things. And the same America that elected 87 new Tea Party-leaning Republican freshmen also reelected Harry Reid, who will stop everything that they try to do. Now, mm-hmm, it's the same country. It's the same country who in 2006 threw Republicans out, 2008 put Barack Obama in, and 2010 gave the Republican Party the largest victory in history when you consider all the state legislative races that came along with it. So, And what I have found, when I go around, people will tell me, you know what, I'm tired of you compromising. You need to stand firm. I don't care what the president wants. The next person, though, with equal fervor says, you guys are idiots. You got to compromise. Oh, you don't control the whole government.
That's loser talk.
Well, I'm just saying that right now we are on thin ice. Congressional approval rating is the lowest ever. I understand why.
Yeah, no one likes you. Your congressional approval rating across the board is, what, 12%, 8%? It's really lousy for you guys.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the good news is we got nowhere to go but up, mm-hmm, unless we drop on down to 0%, which is still possible. But, you know, I think that most people live center right or center left rather than on the hard right or the hard left. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, we need to govern somewhat in the middle. I'm certainly going to be, you know, center right to harder right, but I don't get my way all the time. And Frank Barnes doesn't get his way. Although I do think
name the issue. Okay,
I think you rigged that election a minute ago.
It was not rigged. It was a fair vote.
I was looking at my watch. You had two more minutes to let the other side vote.
Were out of time. Not out of time, but it's like they were out of votes. I mean, somebody already hit 50%. It's a done deal.
It's like a Florida butterfly ballot issue.
You know, and you know who solved that? Chad, the hanging Chad, the pregnant Chad. Yeah, remember that? Same
Chad
guy.
Was here.
Quick question for you.
Is Chad wearing a Boston Red Sox hat today? What is that thing?
He was an Atlanta fan, but you know how that happens. Couple of quick issues I got to hit you with. We heard this thing about a couple of weeks ago, pass the jobs bill, pass the bill, pass it right now, pass the bill. Do you have a bill in front of you from the president about whatever the jobs bill thing? Does that exist?
Actually, unlike other proposals, there is a bill. There's bits and pieces. I don't know if it has been officially introduced, but there has been a draft release. One of the things in there that people don't understand, there's tax increases, there's money for getting out of Iraq that he's planning to spend on his jobs bill. And so that's like you saying, instead of buying a Cadillac, and you know, I'm not going to buy a Cadillac, therefore I've made $30,000 and I'm going to go out and spend something else. Mm-hmm. You're still talking about saving money that you haven't spent. It is a Boston Red Sox.
It's a Georgia cap.
Georgia Bulldogs.
He switched caps.
Yeah, he definitely needs to. He's a Red Sox guy. I knew it.
Next question. Chad's coming back in to defend his honor.
And he's wearing a coat for the weekend.
Yeah, there you go.
You got the Hawaiian shirt on, and he's ready for
November.
He
actually walks around. He wears a coat, and I'm always too hot, and he's always too cold, and it just works that way. Other things we got to talk about is America out of money again. It seems like continuing resolutions, or we're going to keep – would this have been solved had we passed a budget when the Democrats controlled both chambers last year and they never put forth a budget? They haven't put forth a budget. I won't say it was like April 2009 or some incredible number like that. Are we still just sort of limping along here?
We are limping along. You have to have a budget. That's our constitutional job. It's our duty. We're required to have a budget. We can't negotiate with the Senate unless they have a number. Now, we might disagree on how that money's allocated, but we need to get a number. So We're going to get through this period of time. The super committee is meeting, and by November they will have some recommendations, which we will vote for by December. One of the things that we're going to vote on is a balanced budget amendment. In 1995, a balanced budget amendment failed by one vote.
Mm-hmm.
Now, since that period of time, we've spent $9 trillion more dollars in deficit spending, $9 trillion since 1995. Had that passed, we would have been in so much better shape. So while we're going to hear the same old arguments over and over again from those who oppose it, we got to say, didn't we go down that road in 95? And you told us, well, Congress can balance the budget if we have the will. Well, you know, actually, we do have the will, but we don't have the majority that has the will. And so to me, voting for a balanced budget amendment is one of the most significant votes that's going to be coming up this fall.
Now, as you have that happening, also let's talk about the super committee, because this was a responsibility held by hundreds of people in the House and the Senate combined. Now we're down to 12. These are up and down votes. And here's my problem. And Jack Kingston, by the way, is the person we're talking to in the studio right now. The deadline is November. And if not, unless I'm wrong, if I misread this, the cuts, all the automatic triggers would be fired on December 23rd. Now, you guys have faced pressure before, but I can't fathom the pressure of 12 people saying, if you don't do your job on the eve of Christmas Eve, we're going to start throwing people out of their homes. We're going to have the homeless problem. We're going to have kerosene is going to be needed in the Northeast, going to have snowstorms. And it's going to take intestinal fortitude that I can't even fathom. When you say budget cuts, draconian, across the board, will happen right before Christmas. You guys are under the gun in so many ways, I can't wrap my head around it.
But, you know, that might be what it needs to happen. It might be that you got to put a gun to Congress's head, so to speak, in order to make make the decisions that we need to do. And so I think that kind of trigger sounds very dramatic.
It does sound dramatic. It's right before Christmas. I can see the campaign ads right now.
You think the New York Times is going to be pulling for the House Republicans or not?
No, I think a lot of people feel a lot of heat on each side. I just hope that people don't compromise their core values and they say, you know, look, I know this is difficult, but we got to make some hard choices here.
Yes, and I what I'm hoping is that when those 12 people, and remember, even though there are 12 people, there are other committees and subcommittees that are making recommendations and trying to come up with things. For example, you know, I serve on the Ag Funding Committee, and I met with the Secretary of the Agriculture, Vilsack, last week. They're doing reorganization already. And he is a liberal Obama-appointed Democrat, but I'm working with him. Let me give you some of the things that he's told me. USDA has 45,000 cars. They were turning them in every 2 years. Many of these cars really did not even have a lot of mileage on them. And he said to his employees, well, how often do you turn in your own car? And, you know, yeah, it was every 5 years or 10. And he said, why should we be turning in the taxpayer car? So they've stopped that.
Smart.
He found they have 300 cell phone contracts. And look, guys, we can do better than that. We can save some money by consolidating. They have 50,000 buildings owned by the USDA, but different leases for each one. Some of them they don't use anymore. And so, you know, here's an example where, you know, working with a Democrat, we're getting something done. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important for us to keep in mind that unless those type conversations and commitments are being made all over Washington, then when the super committee comes out, it is going to fail. Members have to be proactive in their committees of jurisdiction right now.
Absolutely. Quick question. We've got about 5 minutes left with Jack Kingsale. He's hit with a bunch of things in rapid-fire sequence. Brian Kemp, Secretary of State, just said, hey, we're joining Super Tuesday for March 6th for our primary votes. I thought it'd be cool if we joined Florida on January 31st instead of March 6th. Is there an advance going in March instead of January?
You know, it's done by these parties, and so Republican Party, Democrat Party make certain agreements, and that's why these primaries always start in Iowa, New Hampshire, and South Carolina. I frankly would love to have Georgia vote before them, because I think they have disproportionate influence, because everybody who goes to Iowa has to sign off on the ethanol program, Democrat or Republican,
yeah,
for example.
Yeah, done deal there.
Yeah, so I talked to Brian Kemp about it, and he was trying to figure out a way that our delegates wouldn't be split. You know, if X number go for Newt Gingrich, X number would go for Herman Cain. He was trying to work through that. I don't like being on Super Tuesday because it makes us less relevant. We just don't get the love that we would get if we were earlier in the lineup. But there's not much we Brian Kemp can do about it. But I do think that the parties need to get together and say, look, mix this up. Don't always start with the same suspects.
And you've talked about that before.
Yes.
Over the
on the
years,
show,
y'all
too.
Rotate and stuff like that. Other things I've got to ask about very quickly. You just gave a lot of books to, is it Odom Library?
Well, it's Mobley, yes, at Valdosta State.
VSU, the main library is called Odom, and it's the section of that.
Yeah, Bill Mobley was a guy who actually worked for the Library of Congress and used to get their books and bring them down to Valdosta State. Somewhere along the line, about 10 years ago, he came to our office and said, I know members of Congress get lots of books. What do you do with them? And he kind of said, well, we don't really have a plan. And he said, how about giving them to Valdosta State University?
And
And so
that makes so much sense.
It makes a lot of sense because I can tell you I get a book a week, and these are good books. Some of them aren't so good. Some of them are really hard, crazy stuff, and yet I still pass them on and let them make the decisions. But some of them are, you know, on history books from other countries and economic books and so forth. So we gave about 150 books to VSU yesterday, but we've given others over time. We actually have a section in our office, and anytime we get a book that we know if we've read it or we're not going to read it, it goes to the VSU box, and then we bring them down here.
Very nice. So what's going to
happen? Well, Bill Mobley and the folks over there have been great.
Absolutely, and we're glad the relationship's going to continue, even given the possibility of, well, you're still going to be in our listening area. You'll just be east of Valdosta and a little bit north of Valdosta, but Valdosta proper, it looks like if it goes through the certain muster, it's going to be this Austin Scott character.
Yeah.
I mean, he's probably a nice guy. I shouldn't call him a character like that. Final thoughts. Tim Pawlenty, you can't be his vice president. Okay? So if someone calls up, Herman Cain is now bubbling up the top. Michelle Bachmann's fading. And, you know, I look at these polls and go, eh, who cares? We're not actually voting yet. So if you're not representative, VP in the future, Vice President Jack Kingston, have you got the business cards penciled in
you know,
yet?
I will put my name in the hat. You know, it is interesting. Right now, there's kind of a new candidate of the week. Every 2 weeks, there's somebody else on top. I think it's exciting. I think, though, that the process is still good and we still have a long way to go. This decision may come down to May of next year. Keep in mind, this time last cycle, everybody knew Hillary Clinton was going to be
That's
the nominee.
That's very true.
So I think the process is still good because it is a dynamic process.
Absolutely. Now, we've got 1 minute left of a program before we've got to
I knew
you
I should have
here.
Stalled. I don't
I,
like
I
leaving you with
no,
1 minute.
No. How do people still get in touch with you? Because you're still representing Valdosta.
Yes, and we still have our office here, and Merritt Myers, Shay Walden, and I'm looking for Merritt. She's back there.
Tell you what,
to Lee
there,
Henderson,
there is an email address. There's a website. People can get to, so, but you're still, as much as we say, the outgoing, soon to be no longer, you're still on the case for Valdosta.
Absolutely.
And, of course, the final question with 30 seconds to go. Got to ask you this. Halloween's coming, and you know some people like me love haunted houses. If there's a haunted house around that would give you a free pass to go, would you accept?
Yes, and in fact, you have one here.
We got a couple. We got Phobia, Wild Adventures. There's one up at 5 points. Yeah, we got haunted. So you're a haunted house kind of guy?
Yeah, I love haunted houses.
I mean, you've been in Congress long
you
enough.
Know,
there's
let
nothing
me tell
left.
You, in my remaining 10 seconds, when I was in high school, we actually had a club that every Saturday would go find an abandoned house or abandoned piece of property in Athens, and we'd go explore it. And, that was before the evil trespassing and all the paranoia that we had.
We're going to talk over the break. Thanks so much, Jack Kingston. Appreciate it. Time out right now, WVG. Yeah.